What I'm going to do today is share with you some thoughts about where the industry is going from our point of view and from the learnings that we've kind of aggregated from our members. As Lisa mentioned, we're a membership organization, and I'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute. My own little bit of housekeeping, as Lisa mentioned, if you want to ask me questions, and I would love to take your questions as we go along or at the end, whichever works for you, then please do put them in the chat and I will try to answer them as we go. And if I need to, then I'll ask you to come on and talk to me in person about it as well. But please don't be afraid to do that, because it is quite nice to have it as a dialogue rather than just me talking to you for half an hour, 40 minutes or whatever. So I'm going to show you some slides. Let me jump into those now. And let me first of all put them in the right order, because I have moved them around. Silly me. I'll go back to the beginning. There we go. And these are basically our view on where the industry is going. There's one bit that's missing from this that I will talk about in a second, which is recession and the impact, potential impact of recession. So when we get to the appropriate point in the slide deck, I will stop sharing for a minute and just talk about what I'm seeing in the recessionary environment that we might be facing over the course of the year. But I think the rest of this stuff is pretty universal and is pretty much the continuation of the trends that we saw emerging during COVID. As we enter the post-COVID period, hopefully. A lot of what we learned today is taken from our FIT Congress, which happens every year in June in Lisbon, in Portugal. Some of you were at that event this year. We get 400 plus people from the magazine media industry across the world joining us there to listen to each other and to listen to case studies of success and innovation and all that good stuff. And of course, this was the first time we've done it in person since COVID, so there was lots of good networking going on as well. If you can make a date in your diaries to do that, June the 6th to the 8th this year in the beautiful country of Portugal by the sea, then you'll be able to hear from the great people that I'm referencing today in person rather than hearing it secondhand from me. And obviously in person is always better than secondhand. Let me just open my little chat box so that I've got the thing. There we go. Joanne says, love your background. Yes, I was saying to somebody that's the wallpaper in the hotel, entirely unintentional. But it's a lovely background, isn't it? Very Belgian. So who are we and what do we do? What is FIT? Well, FIT is a trade association. We're a member association, and we are the global trade association for the magazine media industry. Now, a little bit more on that later, but one of the issues that we're facing as an industry is how do we collectively define ourselves in a world where we are all evolving very rapidly into businesses that cover multiple mediums and multiple content types. And when I come on to the increased complexity that we have in the industry at the moment around, or now in the future around those choices, I'll reference the fact that it's causing a little bit of an identity crisis for us. Nevertheless, what do? We do three key things. We help our members to learn from each other and from the broader industry. We do that through knowledge sharing and training. A good example is this today, that this work that we do today in sharing trends. We do that probably once a week to some audience or another across the world. And it really is a crucial way to do that part of our mission. We do networking. We help our members and others to meet each other, but also to meet tech partners and software as a service businesses and other interested parties as part of the industry so that we can all grow together. And then we do some advocacy work as well. We look at topics like sustainability and diversity and international business development, and we help the industry to understand the key trends that are going on in those spaces and give them a voice in feeding back their views on where the direction of travel for some of these important policy areas. We also act as a clearinghouse for policy initiatives across the world. We are not like a traditional traditional trade association. We are not a lobbying association. We don't have a natural government to lobby because we have a global remit. So what we do instead is we try to build understanding about the legislative and policy activity that is happening in every country around the world. And we try to spread that knowledge more widely so that people can understand the impact on them and their businesses. And I'll talk about that also a little bit later. Here are some of the brands and companies that are in our network, that are in our membership. This is just a small selection, but the idea behind this is to show you that we are predominantly a B2C organization, although we do have B2B businesses with us as well. We are predominantly a consumer lifestyle and special interest organization, although we do have news media and television businesses. But I think the real thing to take away from this is that we are a truly global network, and we do have members and connections all over the globe, and we will get examples of best practice from all over the globe. And the nice thing is that our industry, the business models in our industry, are converging globally. Everybody is chasing the same kind of business model, and therefore the learnings and the success that we find can come in any market around the world. It's no longer the case that a select few markets have a monopoly on best practice. We can really find that in any market under the sun. So we're really well placed to take advantage of those global trends. I want to talk at the beginning a little bit about change and the way that change works and our responsibility as senior executives in our industry in relation to change. We are, as a species, pretty bad at estimating the impact of change in the future. We're very good at looking back in the past and understanding how things have changed in our recent history. Think about the growth of the mobile phone and the impact that's had on our lives since the middle of the 1980s. We can clearly see how that has had a dramatic change in the way that we live. But what we're not good at is looking to the future and seeing what the impact is going to be in the future. And in particular, at the moment, when change is happening exponentially, in other words, it's getting faster. Now, we all probably have an instinctive understanding of how change happens. Change happens in S curves. Something new comes onto the market, and at the beginning, nobody has it. And then it goes through a period of relatively rapid, very rapid mass adoption, and suddenly everybody has it and it's become normal. And then we move on to the next S curve, the next change. So those S curves are getting sharper and steeper, and they're getting closer together as change accelerates. And to move it from the theoretical to the real, this is a great graph taken from a relatively old report, but it does illustrate the point very nicely about the rate of proliferation, try and say that after some Belgian beer, proliferation of new technologies over the last 120 years or so. And you can see the S-curve in action here. This is everything from grid electricity on the left-hand side to social media and smartphones on the right-hand side. And you can see the bunching of those lines on the right-hand side as four or five new technologies have come along: the personal computer, the dumb cell phone, the internet, social media, and the smartphone, all in very quick succession, all with very rapid adoption rates, all having clearly an enormous impact on our society. There is also a cautionary tale in this, which is that we do tend to think as humans that we are the most important generation that has ever lived, and that everything revolves around us. It's not always been the case necessarily that that is true. And if you look at some of those technologies from the 1960s, they also had a very, very rapid, even more rapid adoption rate, and arguably an even more rapid impact on the market, being those two being color television and shipping containers. The reason that I can sit here and talk to you on Zoom from my beautiful Apple Mac laptop that's been assembled in China is because it's shipped here in a shipping container, which means it costs $1,000 instead of $10,000 because of standardized shipping containers. So there's a tendency to forget the impact that some of these earlier technologies have had. But why do I show this graph and why do I talk about this? I talk about this because I think one of the main jobs that we have as executives in our industry is to try to anticipate what is going to come on the right-hand side of this graph. What is the next technology or set of technologies that is going to follow this S-curve and have the incredible impact on society and our industry that the smartphone and social media have had in recent years? And what you can relate this to the real life dilemmas that big companies in our space have. Meta and Facebook, Meta stroke Facebook, clearly believe that the next one of these is the metaverse. They believe that that's an S-curve and they are investing in it at the moment while it's at the bottom of the S, so that they can dominate it when it becomes the top of the S. I'm not quite so sure myself. There are other companies that are investing in Web3 technologies because they believe that those will be the next S curve. I think the key thing to be careful of is that you don't invest in a false S curve. You don't put all your money into something that doesn't reach mass adoption, and that you pay careful attention to the rate of change for some of these technologies so that you can spot when they do start to get mass adoption and you can at least be in at the bottom of the S-curve rather than be in at the top when it's much harder to make an impact. And here's just one final proof of the fact that change is accelerating. This is the number of years it took for each of these products to get to 50 million users from the first Commercial airline passenger to the 50 millionth passenger took 68 years. For the same growth rate for Pokemon Go, it was 19 days. So it can happen very, very quickly when the right technology comes along. Now, I also want to put this presentation into some kind of context, and the context of where the industry is right now and where it's going. And part of that context is that we as an industry, an industry association, have to be honest with ourselves and say that our jobs in the old days when it was print were pretty easy, if we're really honest about it. The reason I put this cover up, this is the Time Magazine Person of the Year cover from the year 2000. So this was when George W. Bush had just been elected, before 9/11, when there was still a rosy glow about George W. Bush's presidency. But the reason to put it up is because this was probably the high watermark in terms of the print industry, in terms of its success and its revenue and its profitability. And that's true whether that was in B2C or in B2B. This was Computer World, a very big B2B magazine, which doesn't exist anymore and tells you something in itself, from about the same time. And we had, as everybody I think on this call would probably know, this very strange system that you might call Christmas in July. Why was it called Christmas in July? Because if you worked on a food magazine, as I did, then you would be doing your Christmas shoot in July, and you would go into the office and they would have the turkey and all the other stuff around Christmas laid out and ready and take lots of nice pictures. The lead times were such that you had to do it in July in order to be sure that the magazine would be with the subscribers and on the newsstand in time for Christmas. And what was the model? Well, the model was, if we're being brutally honest with ourselves, we would spend a lot of time writing stuff and taking pictures, and we would put a lot of craft into that work. And then we would spend another load of time laying it out and making it look nice and worrying about the cover. And then if we worked on the creative or the marketing side of the business, there were some people in another part of the building that we tried not to think very hard about because we didn't really like them very much, who sold lots of display and classified advertising on the promise, without the proof, on the promise that loads of people would read the magazine. And we created some systems that we assured everybody were robust to prove this. Then we got another group of people who we never saw because they lived in a completely different city and they worked in some grimy factory to print it and distribute it. And we definitely didn't think about them very much. And then we mailed some copies to subscribers and lists of people. And we didn't worry too much about whether we made any money about this. And if you were in the consumer world, we sent a load of copies into a very inefficient and expensive distribution chain in the hope that somebody buys enough of them to offset the cost of the wasted copies that nobody buys. And we repeated this every month or every week. Now, I'm being facetious and I'm being exaggerating what it is. Why did we do it this way? We did it this way because it worked. It worked creatively. We wrote stories and made content that changed the world, that won awards, and it worked financially. We made loads of money doing it this way. If you look at this, this is Meredith's financial results. You all know who Meredith are, from the year 2000. Look at their EBITDA line, their profit line. They were making almost a 25% profit margin from making magazines. My God, I mean, this is a license to print money. $240 million of profit every year from making magazines. And in those days, they didn't have the magazines that they had now. They had fewer of them and different ones. The same is true of Informa, which was a big B2B company, 2005, still majority in print, 2005, £729 million of turnover and making £91 million of profit, £147 million of operating profit. I mean, incredible numbers. Great time for the industry. And then, of course, as we know, it all changed, and George W. Bush looked sad as a result. And really, there was a series of shocks that led to that change. And those of us who worked in the industry for a long time will remember them. The first real impactful one was the dot-com crash, obviously, and then 9/11. But I think the one that had the biggest impact was the financial crisis. The global financial crisis in 07, 08 led to a step down, a noticeable step down in all of our key numbers. And unlike previous crises, it didn't come back from that step down. It stayed at the lower step. And since then, we've had a series of steps, each one of which for our print businesses has led to a further step down without any prospect of a recovery. And really, we've ended up in a situation where if the 21st century is a century of crisis, then each successive crisis has delivered a successive hit to our industry. And we can see that in the data. This is advertising revenue for newspapers in the US All of the gains that we made since the Second World War in advertising were wiped out in the first 20 years of the internet from the peak in the year 2000. The same is true in circulation. I'll come on to that in a minute. And we've had a successive revelation in recent years as well. Don't worry, this is not all going to be negative, by the way. I'm coming to the good bit at the end. The negative bit's the bit up front where we all have to accept that, things are not the way they used to be. This was a very interesting piece of analysis that came out of the Congress. This is from Ender's analysis in the UK, because I think it dispelled one of the myths that we've been telling ourselves for 10 to 20 years. Those of us who were in the ad-driven part of the business, I think there was always an underlying feeling, well, at some point in the future, digital advertising will replace print and we'll be fine because we'll get back to where we were with print. This graph, if you still believed that, and there still are some people who believe that, this graph should destroy that myth forever. What this graph tells you is that in 2023, the year we're in right now, in the UK anyway, online advertising for the magazine and news market will overtake print advertising for the first time. And actually, up to now, it has not overtaken it, but it will overtake it in aggregate for the first time. But look at the direction of travel of both of those curves. You can see that the peak of print advertising was clearly way higher than it was in 2016. This is coming down a mountain from some lofty peak in the year 2000, as we know from previous slides. But the pink line, the line of online advertising, tells you very clearly that not only is it not going to replace what we had at the peak, it's not even going to get to the level it was in 2016, which was already after two or three successive shocks. So our first key learning that we take from this, online advertising is never going to replace print on a one-for-one basis, ever. And if that's the basis of your business model, you have a big problem. And you can see that in the real world with the valuations of companies like BuzzFeed and Vice, who are predominantly dependent on online advertising. The investors have woken up to this graph and other data like it and have devalued their companies as a result. And I think that's probably the right thing to do. I'm just looking in the chat to see. Wondering if I can see the source of your graph. I can't reference the bottom. This is taken from Ender's analysis. So Ender's analysis is a big British-based data and analytics firm, a little bit like some of the data they provide is a bit like the data that Insider provides. And I can certainly put you directly in touch with them if you want to get this, if you want to get the data from them directly. And then just finally on this, circulation. Circulation also has been in long-term decline, but I think I can see more signs of life in circulation than I can in advertising, in that while the circulation picture is declining, I do get a sense that this does have a bottom that we're approaching pretty quickly, and that you will end up with some kind of stability in the market in circulation that is not the case necessarily in advertising. So what's the position that we're in now as an industry? What is our framework for the industry that we work in? And if you think about the last 20 years, what have we seen? We've seen the move from a position of an industry that had great simplicity in the way that it worked to enormous complexity. If you think about the three critical dynamics of our industry, the content or the service that we're providing, the platform that we're on, and the monetization model, in the old days, for most of us, it was quite simple. We had a print platform where we produced images and text, which we monetized in an indirect way through advertising revenue. Now, not everybody did that, but that's what most people did. But now think about the opportunity driven by the enormously more accessible means of production, our smartphones, video cameras, audio devices, all the rest of it, the mass democratization of distribution enabled by the internet has led to an explosion in the content and service and platforms that we can be on. We can now all do video and audio and data and experiential. We can now do that across radio stroke audio services, TV, in-person, desktop, mobile, social, whatever. And what that is leading to is the direct understanding of what is important to our customers and therefore the change in the business model. Now, part of the change in the business model is driven by necessity, but part of it is driven by ability. We can now directly understand what our consumers want to consume, and therefore we can monetize them directly. Instead of monetizing them via an advertiser, we can monetize them ourselves. So, century of crisis, multiplicity of opportunity, mass complexity. What does it mean? It means that as an industry, we must now have multiple revenue streams. We must have three or four ways to make money to guard against the century of crisis, the century of shocks, and also to safeguard the future of our business. People say, in the old days, they used to say, with great complexity comes great cost and great risk. That can be true. But I think in the 21st century, particularly now in the middle of the 21st century, as we approach the middle of the 21st century, great complexity actually brings an enormous reduction in risk. Because if you have lots of different ways to make money, you are insulating yourself against the shocks that we have. And here is a little bit of a hope for us, the music industry. So this is the industry, this is the revenue from the recorded music industry for the last 20 odd years. In 1999, they were where we were. All of their money came from physical, in their case, from CDs. And they moved to a model over a period of many years where they could accept as an industry an enormous philosophical change in the way that they do business. And their philosophical change, they went from thinking that consumers needed to own music to realizing that consumers only wanted to rent music. Streaming is rental, and streaming is now the majority of that industry's revenue. But, and here is our first bit of good news and good hope, look at the red bar in 2021. Physical revenue for the music industry increased in 2021. And I can tell you it also increased in 2022. What's the largest component of that now in 2022? Is vinyl records. They sell more vinyl records than CDs. They are the largest component of the industry by value and now by volume. What is a vinyl record? A vinyl record is a luxury music product. We tried to buy one recently in the UK. They're £25 each, 30 something bucks. That's a lot of money for a record, 40 minutes of music. When you pay $9.99 for a streaming service that has every music song ever recorded in the history of man, and people are prepared to pay in increasing numbers £25 for 40 minutes of music. This is a lesson for us. We have not had our streaming moment yet. We've not had our Spotify moment yet. And I will come on to what that means for print later on. So just think about the value chain framework of the industry and how that works. We have a bunch of things, the pinky purple things that kind of sit underneath the industry that enable us to do all the stuff that we do. I'm going to talk about some of these in a minute. People and culture, diversity and inclusion, sustainability and technology. Then we have content, data and information, which is the heart of what we do. That's why we exist. Then we have the business model side of it, underpinned by a good first party data model. And most of us will have three areas of business. We will have print, we will have digital, and we will have other stuff, new stuff. Print business models, well known to us, we know. All of us know what those are. The other areas might be things like consulting or education or live events or stuff that's not on that list, but ways that you're figuring out to make money. Good for you. That's your future. That's your innovation thing. But where most of the focus is in the yellow in the middle. And it really is the shift in the middle for most of us in mindset from the digital advertising piece to the digital consumer revenue piece. That is the key trend that we see happening at the moment. And if you want to drill down even further into it, you can say that that comes down to two key things. The only businesses that are going to survive, and I'll be as bold as that, will be the ones that can make at least a third of their revenue from either paid content or e-commerce. If you can't do that, you're out of business. So that's a kind of first wake-up call for everybody who's in the industry to think about. I'll share these slides with you afterwards. That's some good stuff from the FT Strategies about B2B, which is a lot more detailed about how you create a compelling B2B value proposition. I won't go through it because it's very detailed. You can read it afterwards when I share the slides with you. But I wanted to share this with you as an example of a company that has done what we've been talking about. This is Future PLC. They're a British public company. I suspect many of you have not heard of them. They are one of the largest media companies in the US as well now. And they have a market capitalization of $2 billion. When, I don't know whether there's anybody on the call from Meredith, but I can tell you that when Meredith were sold to Dotdash, the other company that could have bought them quite easily was Future. They are that big a player. And you will see them make a big acquisition at some point in the next couple of years. How have they done this? And by the way, sorry, if you look at their share price, which is their publicly quoted company, look at their share price. 10 years ago, they were out of business. Their share price was 10p. Their share price now is 15 quid or something. They've transformed themselves from a loss-making, debt-ridden company into one of the most profitable companies in our industry. How have they done it? They've done it through diversification. And because they're a public company, we have to give them a lot of thanks because they tell us in their annual report how they do it. They provide us with an operating manual for how their business works. I'm going to show you the revenue breakdown of Future a little bit later on. But one of the key things to look at here is their success in e-commerce, where they make about a third of their revenue. And that brings me on quite nicely as well to the other little bit of good news. So when I do all that for preliminary stuff, particularly in person, I see a lot of people and they look like this, you know. Oh God, you know, my business, yeah, that's, I've got print and a bit of digital and I've done digital and I haven't done it very well. And well, the dirty secret in the industry is so is everybody else. There is almost nobody in our industry that has done digital well. This is a fascinating bit of data taken from the newspaper industry and taken from the newspaper industry's global trade body. Look at the numbers on there. Circulation revenue for newspapers in print is 8 times bigger in print than it is in digital. Advertising revenue is 3 times bigger, and the audience is 10 times bigger in print and digital. So for most companies out there, print is still driving almost all of their business. You are not alone. That's the key message from this. You are not alone if your print business is still making money. You are not alone if your print business is still the largest component of your business. And actually, I would argue that that is a healthy thing. It is a necessary thing for many companies. If you want to make the investments that you have to make in digital and in diversifying your revenue into these other areas, you can only do that if you've got a profitable print business to base that on. Because for the first few years, digital ain't going to make you any money at all. It's an investment piece still, even after 20 years of the internet. So let's talk a little bit about some of those enablers. As I've always done, I've spent far too long on the introductory part and not enough time on the main part. But anyway, I'll carry on until somebody tells me to stop. Let's talk about some of the things that enable success in the industry. Talent and culture, really big one. Probably big enough that I'm going to skip over some of the other parts. But the talent and culture piece is really, really crucial. And I would recommend if you do one action from this this talk today, go to the Reuters Institute for the Study of Journalism and download for free, it's a free download, this report, Hearts and Minds, written by Professor Lucy Kung, who presented at our Congress and is coming again to Congress this year. Time to put as much energy into transforming the organization as we do into transforming the product. All of the things that we talk about in terms of diversification and transformation of the organization is enabled by building the right mindset with the leadership team and building the right culture in the organization. And she specifies some of the key things, some of the key success factors that are in there. You've got to lead by example. You've got to figure out how to energize your Gen Y and Gen Z colleagues. You've got to have high thinking and low ego as a leader. Now, this is a radical one. For 100 years, our industry, if we're honest, operated on high ego, low thinking. A simple business does not require a lot of thought, but it does require a lot of ego. Now it's completely the other way around. We've got to think deeply about how business is, and we've got to do it from the point of view of, I do not know anything. If you're the best leader in the world, you'll be the leader who goes into the meeting and sits down and knows less than every other person around the table, and you're there to learn. Be a coach, not a boss. And I think the other crucial one to take from this is avoiding the big bang reorganization. Get the bottom to drive change, not the top, and that's how you can deliver success. So go and download that report, really crucial. You can also talk to our friend and colleague, John Wilpers, who has his own consultancy service, who can tell you his methodology for doing this in practical terms in your organization. Here are some 7 steps from him as to how to do this, which I'll rush through because we don't have time, but you can take these 7 steps and read them afterwards and use them in your business as a little trial as how you might get this process moving. Would also recommend that you go out and read this book, Generation Z, by our friend Chloe Comby. Chloe came and presented this at Congress as well last year. Gen Z audiences and Gen Z workforce are the ones that are coming into your workforce and coming into your products right now. You need to learn how to interact with them because they do think very differently from previous generations. And this book, which is based on interviews with tens of thousands of Gen Z kids, can tell you some of the crucial things that are in there. One of the big ones that came out of this is that everything is political for this group. If you sell beans, as far as they're concerned, beans are a political product, and you cannot sit on the fence and say, I don't care about the politics of beans. You've got to have a position, and you've got to have the right position. Some people will use the dreadful W word that I'm not even going to say the word of because I think it's a totally nonsense made up word. It's not a nonsense word. It matters to these future audiences, and you've got to be part of it. Diversity and inclusion, you all know why it's important. You know about the moral imperative. You know about the economic imperative. All I would take from this, because I don't have time to cover it in the detail it deserves, is to say that we have now loads and loads of proof that companies that have diverse management teams and diverse workforces and reach audiences that reflect the societies in which they work perform better. It's as simple as that. They make more money. So if that's not a reason to do it, I don't know what is, apart from the moral imperative. There are some good ways you can do it very simply. You can start very simply. This is the BBC's 50-50 project. The 50-50 project, all it set out to do was to measure how many men and how many women are on screen and on air on the BBC's television and radio services. That's all it did, just measurement. And by measuring, the teams went, oh my God, it's two-thirds men, one-third women. This is ridiculous. And over time, because of the process of measurement, they've ended up with a 54, or close to a 50-50 balance. So even very simple things like measurement can help you to achieve those things. Technology, buy or build, not going to spend time on this. This debate is done. Nobody builds anymore. Everybody buys. SaaS one, okay? SaaS one as a model, it's better. It's very flexible. It's much more cost effective. You can now increasingly control the dev path as well. And you can see the proof of that when even Jeff Bezos is thinking of selling his in-house tech business. Then you know that it's not the right thing to do to have it in-house. Sustainability, not going to talk about it in any detail because you all know it's important. The consumer thinks it's important. You've got to be able to prove that you understand it and that you can demonstrate to people that you're working to minimize your impact on the environment. And that includes your impact of your digital business. Bitcoin, don't get me started. The biggest bloody Ponzi the world has ever seen. Also, the most environmentally unfriendly. I know there are some efforts going on now to make it more environmentally friendly, but it is still the most environmentally unfriendly thing you possibly imagine. It is a waste of time product that consumes enormous amounts of electricity unnecessarily. It consumes as much electricity as chili. I mean, this is insane. You know, if aliens came down from Earth and looked at this, they would think we were mad. So don't think about just your print business, which is does have a big footprint. Think about your digital business as well, because it has probably a comparable footprint in some areas. So on to the business model areas of this. One of the things that we do at FIP is we produce a range of in-depth reports throughout the course of the year. We do 10 of them. These are kind of 50, 60 page reports that help you manage certain areas of the business. One of the ones we did in the last couple of years was about data and third-party cookies and first-party data and the third-party data strategy. And some really interesting stuff came out of that. The crucial learning from this is that if you want to succeed in all the rest of the digital stuff that we're talking about, you must have a first-party data strategy. As it says there at the top, to own the customer relationship, you must own the data. So you've got to have a strategy here. You've got to have a way to capture and interpret that data. And this is a hard one to do. It's a hard one to do from a technical point of view. It's also a hard one to do from a management and strategy point of view, because at the beginning, it is just a cost. The payoff comes way down the track. It's like planting trees if you're a paper merchant. You know that in 30 years, you're going to get good paper out of those trees. But for the first 30 years, all you're doing is pouring water on them. And it's using up land that you could build housing on, right? It's the same with first-party data. For a while, it's going to deliver nothing. And then suddenly, it will deliver everything. And it is enabling the shift from B2B, from the indirect model to the direct-to-consumer model. Because if you get the right data about your consumers, you can use it to profile those consumers, and you can use that to drive better marketing strategies and customer acquisition strategies for paid content and for e-commerce. That delivers more data, and you end up with a virtuous circle instead of a declining one. There's some work to do around sign-ons. One of the themes that I'm seeing coming out of the industry at the moment is collaboration. For years, we've all been butting heads and competing with each other like mad. Those days are over. Our competition is not each other. Our competition is everybody else. So where we can collaborate, we should. One of the areas we can collaborate in is in boring stuff like consent management and managing privacy legislation. There is no point in 10 companies in a market paying 10 sets of lawyers to give them the same advice. You should get together with your competitors and say, hey guys, we're all in the same business here. Let's come up with a single understood legal position on how we deal with customer data and customer registration, the legalities around that, the terms and conditions, and do that work once and share the cost. And spread that across as many companies as we can and develop the underlying sign-on technology and the underlying customer registration technology. The collaboration, a big thing. There's some action plan stuff you can take there as well. I mentioned vinyl earlier, and I think vinyl does have an impact on print, because I do think we should also be thinking about print's luxury future. Print's role in the media mix in the future will be as a luxury high-value product. We're starting to see that with some brands already. What does that mean? What are the key elements to that? Reduced frequency. seen it with Vogue this week. They're going to do 10 issues this year instead of 11. That's the right strategy. Make each issue of your magazine, if you have a print magazine, an event. Make it an anticipated event. You want people to open the poly wrap, to be looking forward to the thing dropping through the door. How can you do that? You can do that by reversing the strategy that we've had for many years of racing to the bottom. Invest in print and paper. Put more pages in the book. Put nicer paper. Put more content, higher pagination. But, and here's the but, you've got to change the cover price. Our pricing strategy as an industry, I've managed to get 40 minutes, 45 minutes without swearing. Our pricing strategy has been shit for decades. We've been terrified of price. Why the hell does a magazine cost $5 or $7? It should be $15. If a magazine costs less than a bottle of wine, it's too cheap and it's not the right product. And related to that, think about the role of newsstand. If necessary, get rid of it. Focus on subscriptions, direct sale. But don't do it the way we used to do it, where you give people 50 issues for 1 cent or 99 cents or whatever it was. Charge them the correct price for those things. Make a profit on your subscriptions. Get the data from them. This goes back to one of the other themes that people don't like me to say, but I say it anyway. We have got to get used to two things. The first is we were a big industry. Now we're a medium-sized industry. The second thing is that circulation is not ego anymore. 10 million copies, who cares? Give me 100,000 profitable copies rather than 10 million copies. So that's where print is going. And that might be the most crucial thing that we can do for our print business. So I spoke about direct consumer revenue as the most important area of digital development for the future. And I think that has two aspects to it. The first one is digital subscriptions. If you're thinking about digital subscriptions, you've got to have a roadmap. How are you going to get from A to B? How are you going to get from where you are now to building a meaningful digital subscriptions business? Here is quite a nice roadmap developed jointly by our friends at Mather, who you all know because you're coming to the thing in a few weeks' time that they're going to present on, with their customers Roulata, who are based here in Belgium, funnily enough. A little nice little step-by-step guide as to how you can do it. How would I summarize that? Get the right product, get the right audience understanding, invest in the technology, get the right analytics and track the right data and commit to it. Really commit to it and stick to it. The last one is also interesting. A/B test everything. An experiment that did not work is a failure. You will learn a lot. You will learn more from your failures than you will from your successes in this space. The opportunity, if you get it right, can be tremendous. We know what the New York Times' success has been, but, and here's the caveat around the New York Times, the New York Times is the worst possible thing that could ever have happened to our industry because they make this shit look easy and it's really hard and not everybody is the New York Times. The Washington Post lost 500,000 subscribers in the time that the New York Times put on 3 million subscribers. So even Bezos, with all of his brains and his business acumen, cannot make this work as well as the Times can. I'm sorry, I can't see the chat at the moment for some reason because I've lost my mouse pointer. Oh, there we go. Chat, there we go. There's a few questions. Consider content metering as a strategy to acquire new subscribers and convert them to paid. Yeah, absolutely. And when you're thinking about paid content, there's Joanne Pusco. Thank you for that. Joanne, also, I think about the different mix of paid content strategies. There is paid content as a digital subscription, but there is also now the increasing importance of content packages and individual article sales. You know, we did micropayments, it didn't really work. They are coming back again as a tactic. The technology has improved so much on that we can really have that as a thing. Also, if you've got paid content and paid and digital subscription, you don't need to turn off your ad revenue. If you've got the right kind of dynamic paywall, you can keep 80 or 90% of your traffic in front of the paywall and monetize it through ads. Nick, am I saying your 5 bottles of wine are shit? Yes, I am saying your 5 bottles of wine are shit, I'm afraid. What's the balance between paid subs and building data and subscribers? It has historically been either you get one or the other, not both. I think both, Paul. You can, if you do it right, you can build a substantial base of data in front of the paywall with the content that you're giving for free. And then with your premium content, it still provides data, but it also then provides you with a revenue stream. How do you feel about launching news apps versus well-designed mobile optimized websites? I think you go where the consumer is, but you go with the understanding that you have to have the data. So if the app allows you to keep the data, then do it because somebody will want it. If the app doesn't allow you to keep the data, then don't do it. This is why I'm very down on things like Apple News Plus. Apple News Plus is great, traffic, gives you some traffic, gives you money, whatever. But it's kind of pointless because you don't get the data, and data is the gold. Apple don't do that out of the goodness of their hearts. They do it because they want the data, right? The other thing about digital subscriptions is we are terrible as an industry at pricing as well. What we did with digital subscriptions is we looked at the way that we sold print subscriptions, and then we just put those prices on the internet. 52, this was taken from the Spotify guy who said he went through three or four different print companies and looked at their digital pricing strategies and just went, this is just confusing. £52 for 52 weeks. I think that's the New York Times. £1.71 a day, £1 for blah, 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 blah. It's just confusing. Spotify is $9.99 for a reason, right? Because it's easy to understand and it never changes and it's easy to pay $9.99. So pricing can be an area of complexity. E-commerce, rattling through e-commerce. Really, this is about the connection between content and transaction. So we, as media businesses, whether we're in B2C or in B2B, what is the thing that we have built up? We've built up reputation and we've built up trust with our audiences. Now, there was some debate about whether or not it's the right thing to do to use that trust to convert it to transaction. I think if you do it in the right way, it can be incredibly powerful. It can certainly be incredibly lucrative. You need to put the right safeguards around it. You need to be aware, this is taken from St. Joseph's Communications in Canada, by the way. You need to be aware, as they are, that the journey, the user journey, does not end with the purchase. It ends with advocacy, with getting somebody to recommend the experience, because that enhances and builds trust for the next transaction. But it can be incredibly lucrative if you get it right. This is taken from Future PLC again. This is in their annual report. They emphasize the importance of trust and of having a separation between what they're recommending and what people are buying in their process and being editorially independent, because they believe that's what makes the content credible and that's what therefore makes the transaction more likely to happen. So don't be worried about, this is the same debate we used to have with native advertising. Oh, we'll pollute our editorial teams with this, that, and the other. Your editorial teams are the best people in the world to tell you where the line is, because they will ruthlessly safeguard the trust and reputation that they've built up with their audience, and you should listen to them. What's the potential for this? This is revenue. This is the revenue breakdown from Future. I told you we would look at that earlier. So this is Future PLC's revenue breakdown. They're a multi-hundreds of millions of pounds revenue company, so very, very large business. One third of their revenue comes from e-commerce affiliate. They review a stereo and somebody buys it from them. And now what did they buy recently? They bought a price, not a price comparison. Yes, they did. They bought a price comparison website for insurance. So their rationale is anybody who buys anything from us needs insurance, so we'll sell them insurance as well. So that number is only going to go up in the next few years. And you look at their breakdown of their revenue, a third of it's print, a third of it's advertising, and a third of it is traditional legacy revenue. Very, very smart company. I spoke about advertising a lot, and the thoughts about advertising are changing all the time. It is always going to be an important part of your makeup, and the nature of the importance has changed. Until very recently, this slide said that Google and Meta and Amazon were dominating that space. But in recent months, we've seen that the data is proving that their dominance is dying, that ad money is flowing away from particularly Google, also from Meta, towards us, towards direct relationships with the people who own the audience relationship around content. And that's something we should be taking advantage of. One of the things I've heard recently, turn off your programmatic advertising. It's doing nothing for you. Move back to a direct relationship model. Look at native as being really, really important. The share of digital advertising is going to continue to grow. And our share of it is now starting to grow again, having not grown for a very long time. So we have a great opportunity to kind of reinvigorate our digital advertising business. Again, collaboration has been a theme here. This is in the programmatic spaces. It's happening in the UK, where a bunch of publishers have gotten together and gone into what's called the Ozone Marketplace, where they sell their audiences as one unit, as one group, higher quality, larger volume, better prices, better CPM. So that collaboration can really work. Don't rule out collaboration in any area of your business. If there's a way to work with your biggest competitor, in inverted commas, go and figure it out. Go and sit down and have a nice lunch with them and say, hey, times have changed. Let's buy stuff together and do stuff together, because that will be a better result for you than competing with them. Platform focused content, this complexity that we've had in the ability to create new content on the platforms we work across, or is leading to fantastic opportunities. This is a brand in Italy called Giallo Zafferano, which is a food and recipes brand. And this is a great example of them, of how they use different platforms, not only to kind of recreate and recut the content that they're creating, but to use that to reach different audiences. So in this example, they've got one recipe across Facebook, Instagram, TikTok, and YouTube. masses of engagement, loads of views, but also different audiences. So you look on the left-hand side, they are reaching their traditional legacy 35 to 54 audiences through their website, through Facebook, and through long-form video. And on the right-hand side, they're reaching Gen Z audiences through Instagram, TikTok, creative videos, and short videos. So they are taking fundamentally the same recipe, the same piece of content, doing it different ways, and massively extending their audience reach. So thinking about platforms and thinking about how you use platforms in a smart way is a really good one. I've got a comment in the chat, which I can't see, which I'll come to in a minute because I've nearly finished. Good example of a new platform and a new way to think about content is podcasting. Everybody talks about podcasting. Podcasting is a fantastic medium to think about if you're not already in it. It does have one great advantage in that there is an independent podcast distribution platform in every country around the world, so you don't have to rely on Apple or YouTube or any of those other big tech companies. You can use the BBC if you're in the UK. In America, you can use NPR. And audiences love them. Look at the proportion who used a podcast in the last month. 46% of the people in Ireland, in the US, 37% of people. The other crucial stat from this is that people do listen to and finish podcasts. I think the average listening time for a podcast is 47 minutes. The average watching time for something like a Facebook video is 7 seconds. So the that engagement soon adds up across time. Not going to talk about content distribution because that's changing quite a lot, but you all know the problem there. Google and Facebook still rule the show. The good news is that there is a lot of regulation coming down the track in a number of different areas that's going to affect this. And one of the other things I would advise you to do is to keep a close eye on what's happening in the legislative and policy space across the world. That falls into a number of different areas. There is privacy that all of you probably know about with GDPR and CCPA. There is also monopoly and anti-monopoly moves to break up, particularly Google's monopoly of the ad market. There are moves to make the big tech platforms pay for content that has happened in a number of countries across the world. Google, in particular, are terrified of this and are trying to head it off with preemptive deals. So keep an eye on that. And there is piracy and the unauthorized distribution of our content on things like messaging platforms, which, again, will get a lot of attention. Very quickly at the end, M&A and consolidation. Why is everybody doing a lot of this stuff? They are doing it because everything is for sale. Every business in our space is for sale. Everything must go. There have been more deals in the last 4 years than there were in the last 40 years. You will see more of them. More of these companies will get bought and sold. What does it mean? If our good friend Reed Phillips was here, he would thank me for stealing his slide. It means that when board members and boards are making strategic decisions about their businesses, they're doing it with one eye on the EBITDA multiple that they can get when they sell the company. So if they have two projects to choose between, a new print magazine or a new information and data business, they will choose the information and data business because that's worth 15 times EBITDA and the print business is only worth 6 or 7. And they know the company is going to be sold at some point because everything's for sale. So that's driving a lot of the decision-making in the industry. The future in Web 3.0, I don't want to talk about this too much because most of it is bullshit. NFTs, Ponzi, cryptocurrencies, it's a Ponzi. Why the hell are people paying for JPEGs? I have no idea. I mean, I thought I'd seen everything in the world until you get somebody to pay for a JPEG. Fine, whatever. I do think there is quite an interesting thing for us to think about this idea of the direct relationship between the creators and their communities. So what the blockchain might do, which underpins all of this, is it might allow creators to build their own relationships with communities and to get paid for it. But then again, they've been doing that for hundreds of years, so I'm not sure it's necessarily that different. Van Gogh sold his paintings to everybody on his own. He didn't rely on a broker. So where are we now? We are at the end of the beginning. The internet is not new. We've been doing this shit for 25 years. So it's not some new, wonderful, emerging technology. And we need to start getting it right. And hopefully some of the things that we've seen in there will start to help us to get it right. We do produce a report every year, an innovation report, which summarizes all the things that are happening in this space. If you'd like a copy, get in touch with me. It's free for FIP members. If you want to join FIP, then please do go to FIP.com or email me, james@FIP.com, to tell me, and I can tell you about how we can help you and what the rates are and all the rest of it. If you do get the chance to come to the Congress, it's June the 6th to the 8th in Lisbon, in Portugal, 400 people. Great chance to be a part of the community and see what's happening there. But crucially, if you have questions about this, then please do email me, james@fit.com. I'm always here, always happy to hear from people, and would love to take any questions that anybody might have.